Welcome to another episode of the Converge podcast, where we seek to help you have a Christian worldview in a non-Christian culture. My name is Steve.
My name is Nate.
We are both pastors at Village Church, and this is where doctrine and mission converge. Again to the Converge podcast. Today we are really going to be kind of when we say this is where doctrine and mission converge or collide. Today really is going to be, I think, a good example of that. We're going to be talking about the 10 books every Christian should read, and I think some of the books on this list are going to surprise people because you might be thinking we're going to talk about all Puritans or Calvin's Institutes or, you know, Bavinck or, you know somebody that's been dead for a few hundred years and makes us look really just heady and like we're just brilliant intellects, which is what you get with a lot of people. But really the way that this list kind of came is I was talking to a few people about some work that I was doing in kind of evidential apologetics. And I was talking about, they were asking me about primary sources that I was using. And so I noticed that a couple of them were writing down the books that I was talking about. And I just kind of paused and I was like, wait, you shouldn't read these books. And they wanted to know why. And I explained, I was like, there are probably 100 books that you should read that are going to be far more helpful for you in your discipleship, in your walk with Christ, before you should ever even consider reading these books.
Yeah, absolutely. So we're not saying these are the 10 best books ever written. No. We're not saying these are the 10 most important books in the history of the Christian faith. We're just saying, hey, if you're coming up to us and you're saying, I want to grow in my discipleship, and you're just an average person in the church, what are 10 books that would really help me out? And this is going to be some of our answer. We're not saying we couldn't think of another 10, but this is a great 10 to start with.
These are just the 10 we picked.
Yeah.
They've all had an impact on us. I think right now is probably the most difficult time to be a discerning reader and really have discernment in what you're reading for your discipleship, because I think every year the marketing is crazy. This is the best book on this subject. Yeah. This is the new philosophy that you need to know about. This is everything that you need to know in book form, the best book I've ever read. And it makes it, I think, very difficult for people to know, where do you even start? Because we do not, if we're very honest, we do not have a culture, both inside and outside of the church, of reading.
Yeah.
And I have long maintained and long told people that, you know, God chose to give us revelation in written form. Therefore, if you're going to be a disciple, you need to become a reader. And so for some people, it starts with, you know, certainly learning to read. Mm-hmm. But then secondly, learning to read books. And the issue is I'll have so many people, I'm not a reader. And it's like, yes, you are. Yeah. You just read things that matter to you, whether it's articles, whether it's, you know, sports stats, whatever it is. If you want to learn how to follow Christ effectively in your life, and certainly if you want to learn what it is to multiply your faith in other people, you're going to have to read certainly the scriptures. Above all, it's the Word of God. Yep. While you're reading any book that we recommend, you should be reading the scriptures multiple times. But the key is, so many people are reading bad books. They're interested in specific theories. They're interested in specific philosophies, but they haven't yet built a foundation upon which to even have a rubric for understanding new philosophies. You shouldn't start in apologetics. You should start in simply understanding what it is to be a Christian. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of where these books come from. Again, you can nitpick this list. You can talk about how we haven't included any, you know, 1,500-page theological epics. Oh, where's Calvin's Institutes? Where are 10 different, you know, Puritan theologians? Yeah. Oh, my goodness, you didn't even include mortification of sin in this list, you know, and it's true. We didn't. We also aren't including any hermeneutics books. We're not including books on how specifically to study the Bible. Not because that doesn't matter. It does. But quite frankly, most people should start by reading a study Bible, but it's going to be encouraging if you also start with this type of stuff so that you don't get overwhelmed with gaining tools in kind of an academic sense. So here's the top 10 list, and I'm gonna qualify it by saying these are 10 books that every member of Village Church needs to read. I think these books are profoundly readable. We're going to have Amazon link down in the notes of the podcast so that you can go and find each of these books to order them. I think all of them are available on Kindle. A lot of these books I've had for many, many years. A few of them I have read multiple times, but I want to get right into the list. First, I want to start with Knowing God by J.I. Packer. And I would say this is a great book really to begin to understand theological language, to start to understand what is theology. And this is just a great place to start with that. It combines a great understanding of who God is, but it also gives you a great understanding of how God works in the world and in our lives through the gospel. And I think just to sum it up, this book answers two vital questions for living the Christian life. First, it answers the question, who is God? Then it answers the question, how does God work in my life? And what's important about this text, as well as all the books on the list, is that it pays great attention to what does the scripture say. And so while these aren't Bible study method books, these books will help you know how to study the Bible by the way that they deal with the Bible. And so Packer really explains God through a biblical lens in this book.
Absolutely. Knowing God, it is an introduction to theology in a very real way because it starts to get you familiar with theological language, but he does it in a way that's very interesting, very relevant. It makes you want to know more about theology. I would say for this book, if you wish you could go deeper in your understanding of God and faith and Christianity, that is a really good place to start because it's not overwhelming. It's very practical, but it is deep. It absolutely is. I think that is a book that could have helped a lot of people who grew up in a church and didn't get much of a foundation in theology. Theology was kind of treated as unimportant. That's a really good book to start with to kind of combat this idea that theology doesn't matter. You can't read that book and think theology doesn't matter.
Yeah, when a lot of people are recommending books on theology, to especially young Christians or people who haven't built a habit of reading, they'll immediately point to Grudem Systematic Theology, you know, Millard Erickson. Yeah. You know, last year a Bavinck book came out that's been edited to be kind of his systematic theology in a sense. But I think this is a better book to recommend because of the way he writes and because, I mean, most people have never read a book that's over 1,000 pages. And so if that's where you start, it's going to get discouraging. Mm-hmm. And so I think that this is a good book to really jump into understanding theology and beginning with just what is God like? Who is God? What has God done? Yep. Notable quote from that book is from inside of the book: disregard the study of God and you sentence yourself to stumble and blunder through life blindfolded, as it were, with no sense of direction and no understanding of what surrounds you. This way, you can waste your life and lose your soul. I think that's an important way to understand why Packer wrote this book. He wants people to understand who God is. Now, a couple of these we're going to cheat because we're going to pick two books and treat them as though they are one book. And the first example of that is R.C. Sproul's The Holiness of God, but then secondly, R.C. Sproul's Chosen by God. And I think these two are really good companion pieces to one another. I would start with The Holiness of God, then I would go to Chosen by God because one is, again, I think it's building on, and kind of the order that I put all of these recommendations is to help you learn how to think and then help you learn how to live.
Yeah.
But the way the holiness of God presents what Packer starts with is that this one solely focuses on what does it mean that God is holy? Because I know we say that a lot. I know people talk about, you know, God is holy, and they read it in the Bible. But the question is, do you understand what it actually means that God is holy?
Yep. Everybody needs to read some R.C. Sproul.
Yeah.
He's so great in the way that he, and again, this is, I think it's important that we started here with Packer and Sproul. They're very deep while being super accessible.
And what I love about Packer and Sproul is there is a shift right now in pastoral ministry where everybody wants to be an academic. It's changed over the past 10 years. Everybody thinks that we need to use language that normal people don't use. Everybody thinks we need to study philosophies that nobody uses. And Packer and Sproul were both academic giants. They were both intellectuals. But the key with Packer and Sproul is that they sought to apply their understanding of God, their understanding of Scripture, and especially with Sproul, because he was a philosopher, his understanding of philosophy in order to help church members think rightly about God, live rightly towards God, and build a lens through which they could see false teaching and error, not because they understood all of the lingo, but because the more you know about the Bible, the more you know of a right thinking process about God, it will expose false teaching much quicker. And the holiness of God just builds on that one attribute of holiness, and then it applies God's holiness to our everyday lives. The more that you focus on specific attributes of God, you're going to learn how to live the Christian life. But then we also included Chosen by God. And Chosen by God is Sproul's explanation of the sovereignty of God in salvation. He goes through the 5 points of Calvinism. He even relabels them. You know, TULIP is the normal acronym. And Sproul explains why he doesn't think TULIP is the best acronym that could be used, because he thinks it's false advertising. And he kind of rearranges it and talks about it in what I think is a more helpful way. And he explains, how does a holy God save sinful man?
Yeah. And again, what he does, he's very plain spoken. He lays out the truth, and then he takes care to make sure that he explains why this matters for your life, which is really important. He's not just giving, hey, this is the doctrine. He absolutely gives that in a great way. But then he says, and this is why it matters. This is how it changes the way you relate to God, you relate to the world. Very practical, very helpful.
Yeah, it kind of starts you on a path of applying the holiness of God to understanding what it means to worship and follow Jesus. Yeah. And then, of course, in Chosen by God, he applies that to the sovereignty of God really in everyday life. So if you're a person in Village Church and you've heard us use that scary word Calvinism a few times, and you are really, you're kind of like, ooh, I don't know about that, Chosen by God is where I tell everyone to start in understanding from a pastoral perspective, not just why it's true, but why we take joy in it being true, why we glory in it being true. And I've got a couple of quotes from the books. This one's from Holiness of God. Sproul writes, he says, God's justice is never divorced from his righteousness. He never condemns the innocent. He never clears the guilty. He never punishes with undue severity. He never fails to reward righteousness. His justice is perfect justice. And then here's a quote from Chosen by God, very short quote, left to themselves, no one will ever choose Christ. And I think those are a couple of really good quotes to get you interested in Sproul's frame of mind. Just those books have been, and years ago they were, and to this day, I find them to be extremely helpful in understanding, but also in explaining some of the more difficult things about understanding God. Now, the third one, we cheated again. We combined two books, but they really are, one is a sequel to the first. And so it's a couple books by John Macarthur. The first one is called The Gospel According to Jesus. The second is called The Gospel According to the Apostles. And there is truth in advertising, because that is literally all he talks about for a few hundred pages in both of these books. In the first book, he talks about, he just takes sayings of Christ from the four gospel accounts and explains, what does the gospel mean according to Jesus? And the second one does the same thing with the words of the apostles in the New Testament. Is what does it mean in the pastoral epistles and just the letters of Paul and John's writings and in the book of James? What does it mean to be a follower of Jesus Christ? And it answers, both of these books answer one vital question. What does it mean to follow Jesus?
Yep.
And so these were written in response to what was a theological controversy, you know, years ago. It was called the Lordship Salvation Controversy, which was all over one question. Can Jesus be your Savior if he isn't your Lord? In other words, can you have saving faith in Christ if it hasn't changed your life to where you are actively seeking to obey the commands of Christ in Scripture?
Yeah, I mean, you said it. These books both answer the question, what does Scripture, and that's the key part. It's not what does John MacArthur think. He's laying out what does Scripture say about what it means to follow Jesus. And it, can you follow Jesus if you just say a prayer and then nothing in your life changes? Or is there something to actively submitting to Jesus as Lord in your life? And what he does in these books is he lays out Scripture after Scripture after Scripture that just makes it very clear that you have to make Jesus Lord of your life in order to follow him. He's not promoting works-based salvation. That's not what he's doing at all. He's just simply saying, this is what Scripture says, that we are saved by grace through faith. But if we are saved by grace through faith, it's going to result in a life where Jesus is Lord. And this is what Scripture says about that. Really helpful for just kind of solidifying, okay, am I following Jesus?
Yeah.
Books are helpful for that.
It's really, really helpful. People that are struggling to figure out, okay, do I have assurance of salvation? Or, you know, how do I explain what it means to have assurance of salvation? These books are great in explaining that.
And I would say these books are not going to cause you to doubt your salvation.
No.
They're written to cause you to have assurance of your salvation because these are the actual words of Scripture. And then and you're following Christ like he says you need to.
Yeah, that's my favorite thing about MacArthur, and really in any of his books, is that MacArthur is not heavy on this is what I think. MacArthur is very heavy on this is what the Scripture says. And I mean, these books just explain the fact that faith in Jesus will change your life to where you are bearing fruit of obedience subsequent to your salvation. So you can say, okay, I became a Christian and now I am living a life to bear fruit that proves that I actually did become a Christian.
We could go on and on, but the point is you need to read the books.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. A notable quote from that book, when Jesus called people to follow him, he was not seeking companions to be his sidekicks or admirers whom he would entertain with miracles. He was calling people to yield completely and unreservedly to his lordship. So Jesus is Lord. Now, there are, I think some of these books, depending on, you know, what your posture towards anybody, could be a little controversial, but there are two specific books that especially those who are Reformed in their leanings, you're probably going to question my pedigree in being Reformed because I gladly recommend both of these books.
Wouldn't be fun if we didn't do this.
Yeah, though. I gladly recommend these books on a regular basis, and they do explain kind of how we have what our philosophy of ministry is, how we posture ourselves towards ministry. And so the first of those two books is a book called The Barbarian Way by Erwin Mcmanus. This book has been so helpful to me over the years. It's a quick read. I'm a fan of Mcmanus. You know, I don't agree with everything Mcmanus says, everything Mcmanus does. I don't feel the need to qualify that too much. But he is so helpful in really unlocking hope that God has designed me to live a life of walking into a future that he has made for me. And really, Barbarian Way is a guidebook to living out faith in the gospel in a safe, risk-averse culture that trains us to reject that idea.
Mm-hmm.
Mcmanus kind of looks at it and he says, for the most part, people believe that we are to be good, you know, moral Christians with no sense of adventure or mission. If you want to get a sense of adventure for the mission of Jesus, the barbarian way is so helpful.
I think it'd be really helpful for you. And just to add to what you said, you know, if you gave us a longer list, we'll find more guys who do church differently than us that we would still recommend. And we can even be honest and say, look, in the 15 years since Mcmanus has wrote this, he has drifted in ways that I wish he hadn't. But that is true of so many books that are helpful. I mean, don't get us talking on C.S. Lewis. You know, you want us to only read dead guys. There's a dead guy who's got a ton of ways he did church and lived that I would completely disagree with. So that cannot be your determiner for which books you do and do not read. And there are some books that have a faithful message that is so important that it makes the book very much worthwhile. And this is one, because that message of avoiding a risk-averse, nice guy Christianity, that is a message our culture needs. I think I would say it needs it more now than 15 years ago when he wrote that.
Oh, absolutely. And it's fantastic because he just takes a look at, and this is what's so funny is that, especially last year, he rails against this idea that Christians are to be the most civilized people, that we're just supposed to be these nice people in a world. And if anybody thinks that we're just not the nicest and safest and most clean-cut people, then you know, we're not doing everything we should. Mcmanus comes in and he says, no. We've got to have a barbarian way about us where we are following Jesus at the risk of being called undignified.
Yeah.
We are forming discipleship in ways that the world is going to look at us and say, you are not civilized. You know, we are people who risk. We are people who adventure. We are people who love the world through ways that are going to be called unloving at times. And here's a notable quote. We created a religion using the name of Jesus and convinced ourselves that God's optimal desire for our lives was to insulate us in a spiritual bubble where we risk nothing, sacrifice nothing, lose nothing, worry about nothing. Yet Jesus' death wasn't to free us from dying, but to free us from the fear of death. Jesus came to liberate us so that we could die up front and then live. I cannot express enough how helpful I think that philosophy is for follower of Jesus Christ.
Yep.
The fifth book on the list is The Pursuit of Holiness, and you moved it, and I don't know where it is now. Well, there it is. All right, it's The Pursuit of Holiness by Jerry Bridges. This is, bought this copy, I think, my freshman year of college. I have thumbed through this so many times. This is an amazing book that focuses solely on what it means to live life seeking to obey Scripture, thereby pursuing holiness.
Yeah, so while holiness of God is primarily about God and how he's holy, it gets to practical living from that, but that's its primary focus. The primary focus of this book is practical living, and Jerry Bridges is just so great at doing that, and he makes you want to do that too, which I think is a real helpful part of this book.
Yeah, it's helpful in explaining why you should want to obey God, you know, why your desires should shift over there, because you're going to have a better life obeying God than disobeying God. And it just lays out what it means to obey God's commands through the power of the Spirit. He even talks about kind of the misunderstanding that we don't have a responsibility where the Holy Spirit will just take care of everything. And so we don't have to make this decision to obey God versus sin. And he's very clear about personal responsibility of living a holy life in this book. And he explains so well why sin is a serious issue that requires real and continuous repentance.
Yeah, I think books like this are good because it's going to make you humble, just realizing how much growth is still needed in your life. But he does it in a way that, like we said, is gentle. And I mean that. It's like you're going to be convicted, but he's not going to beat you up. It's really good.
And he just explains that following Jesus is impossible without a clear realization that it demands that you live a life of obedience to the commands specifically in Scripture, and that you're never going to grow in your faith if you have a refusal to turn from sin and trust the gospel of Jesus Christ. Yep. A notable quote from that book, God wants us to walk in obedience, not victory. Obedience is oriented toward God. Victory is oriented toward self. And that's one of my favorite things is that he explains why we shouldn't talk about what we have failed. No, he says, you disobeyed. You know, it's not about seeking victory. It's about seeking obedience. It's a fantastic book. And I know a book that you and I are both really big fans of, and not just this book, and I'm going to cheat again.
Okay.
You should read everything Larry Crabb has ever written about anything. Larry Crabb has been one of the more helpful authors. He's a Christian. He was a Christian counselor. He passed away actually very recently. But his works were foundational. One of our college professors recommended we start reading Larry Crabb, who he wasn't even a counseling professor. He was a New Testament professor, and he recommended reading Larry Crabb. So we started reading Larry Crabb, and a lot of the ways that we treat counseling and we treat dealing with issues and really life change flow from Larry Crabb. And so if I was only going to read one Larry Crabb book, though, I would read Inside Out. And I think it's really where you should start with reading Larry Crabb. It just takes a look at what the change that God wants to make in our lives actually looks like. It covers really that this temptation happens where we are tempted to change our outward behavior rather than allowing God to do the real work of transformation on our hearts to then... It comes on the outside, but it starts on really having a focus on the key question, why do I do the things that I do? Why do I act the way that I act? It doesn't start with just saying, stop acting that way. Crabb forces you to think beneath your actions and your activities to whether they're good or bad actions or activities. That's one of my favorite things about this book. He doesn't say, why do you do bad things? No, he says, why do you even do good things? Because if you do a good thing for the wrong reason, it's a bad thing. You have to look on the inside and really do that hard work. And he uses a key term that I use all the time, and it's over the issue of self-protection. It's not a term that people use a lot, but many Christians, according to Crabb, busy themselves with what he calls good moral activity in order to avoid dealing with the narcissistic motives or even past hurts that God wants them to deal with so that they can actually experience real transformation, real life change.
Yeah. One of the things that I love about Crabb and this book in particular, one, he does love the church. Like he's constantly referencing the church, even though it's not a primary focus of what he's doing. But he is very concerned that we are not fake Christians and that we're not making churches full of fake Christian peoples, because he sees that, and I think it's accurate, as a big turnoff to the faith. And it's not helpful for anyone. And so he's really trying to help you. And this is a term that can be used poorly now, I think, but he's using it in a good way. He's trying to help you be authentic, but in a scriptural, biblical way. This is what a self-help book should be.
Yeah.
This is what a Christian self-help book looks like.
Yeah.
Because Crabb is very honest about our fallenness, about our sin nature, and about how it's not about getting beyond that, but about actually dealing with it.
Yeah. The problem with the way people treat authenticity is they want to be authentic about how imperfect they are with no desire and no hope of ever changing.
Yeah.
And Crabb fights against that. And he would even say that that is self-protection.
Yes.
If you don't desire the change that God wants to make on the inside of your life, to change your joys, to change your affections, to forgive people that have hurt you, to move forward, Crabb would say that's not authentic. That's just self-protection. You're trying to build something around yourself. And so the book is great in aiding us to understand why the motive for why we do things is so important. And I think it's one thing that people struggle with when they're trying to become a leader in our church, is that we deal with that type of stuff. I'm not as interested in your ability to do things. I'm interested in figuring out why is it that you want to do this? Because I have no desire having people doing a bunch of Christian activities if they're just doing it for the wrong reasons, and it's just a way to protect themselves from the real work that God wants to do in their lives. Notable quote from Inside Out: biblical change never requires us to pretend that things are better than they are. Christ warns us to face reality as it is, including all the fears, hurts, resentments, and self-protective motives we work hard to keep out of sight, and emerge as changed people, not pretenders, not perfect, but more able to deeply love because we're more aware of His love. And so if you're willing to commit yourself to the life of transformation that God has for you, you're going to have a better life. Now, the second book on the list that I think could ruffle a few feathers, I even hear people inside of our church bash old Rick Warren, but one of my favorite books, and it's a book that people are often surprised that I recommend freely, because I think if you're going to be a disciple, if you're going to grow in your faith, The Purpose-Driven Life by Rick Warren, if you can hold it up right there. It's on your side. Purpose-Driven Life by Rick Warren is a great place to start. Now, this specific copy is interesting because if you went to Liberty University and you were there when Rick Warren came, this is one of the free $7 books. Now, I got a few of those free $7 books because I was actually tasked with handing out, I think it was around 7,000 copies. I was in charge of distributing a copy of Purpose-Driven Life to every single student at Liberty University.
Yeah.
So if you were there in those days, there's a great chance that you held me personally responsible for that $7 charge that went on your account when Dr. Falwell said it was going to be a free book.
Yeah.
But I had, as I explained to so many people, I was just part of the machine, man. I had nothing to do with who got charged. I just handed out all the books.
It was a great time to be alive.
Oh, man. It was, just quick, at 11 o'clock at night, I was going dorm to dorm with hundreds of copies of this book in the bed of my truck.
Yeah.
It was amazing. Was crazy. And I actually got to spend time with Pastor Warren during that time, and I found him to be one of the kindest, really polite, took time to actually talk to me. And he talked to me about this book, and let me tell you, he was a legit dude. He's a good guy. I really enjoyed the time that I spent with him.
So we were fortunate enough to be at Liberty right when this book came out, and we were fortunate enough that I think what happened was Dr. Falwell actually called up Rick Warren and said, will you come to Liberty and just base a conference on this book? So right when it came out. And so then he famously said, all the students are going to get this book for free. And then a $7 charge popped up on their account for the book. Which, here's the funny thing about this. At the time, we were college students. Understandably, everyone's complaining about this. It's the cheapest bogus college fee I've ever had. So I didn't mind it too much. But here was my thing at the time. And this kind of launched us into talking about the book. I was a 20-year-old at the time, biblical studies student. And so I actually was interested because it was popular, famous. I wanted to see, I read it. And so everyone's complaining about this fee. And I'm just sitting here as a 20-year-old thinking, but did you actually read the book? Because it's kind of amazing.
Yeah. A lot of times when people mock this book, I instantly know they haven't read it.
Yeah.
I instantly know that they don't know what's actually inside of the pages of this book. Because what is inside of the pages of this book is so profoundly biblical, is so gospel-centered. You cannot, I don't care how mature or immature you are in your faith, you cannot read this book and, number one, become convicted of sin, but then, number two, see the hope of really having the purpose of God flowing out of your life. And again, the thing with the disagreements, I'm sure that they're there, but keep in mind, R.C. Sproul's a Presbyterian.
Yeah.
I'm not a Presbyterian, and I still recommend R.C. Sproul.
We're not endorsing everything Rick Warren has ever said or done, of course. That's true of every single book here. But this book, I mean, if you'll just give it a read, the things that it covers: life's not about you, it's about God. Obey God, learn to follow Him, join a local church, get on mission with that local church. I mean, this is just the most basic stuff that a follower of Jesus needs. I would give this to any new follower of Jesus, but also there are plenty of people who've been following Jesus for decades who would benefit from actually implementing the things Rick Warren talks about.
And
here,
some of the same people that would criticize this book and say, oh no, you need to go read John Owen or John Flavel instead and all this stuff. And I've read those guys too. But those same people are people who don't live with a purpose. They lock themselves away in their houses. They read theology. They read discussion boards online, and they read discernment blogs, and they do nothing. They have no direction. They have no purpose. This book is amazing because it actually gives you, over 42 short chapters, purpose. Yeah. the book is about exactly what it says it's about. It is about finding the purpose of God in your life.
And critically, where so many other things out there before this and since this fail, this book grounds the purpose in God.
Yes.
You cannot create your own purpose. That is one thing that needs to be understood. You cannot read this book and come away with the idea that you get to define your own purpose for yourself and then slap God's name on it.
Yeah.
It's God's purpose in your life.
Absolutely. So I love this book. I've been aided by this book, and I have known many people who have been aided by this book. A notable quote, and it's the first two sentences in the book, I think sells the whole book for me. It's not about you. The purpose of your life is far greater than your own personal fulfillment, your peace of mind, or even your happiness. If more Christians lived out those two sentences, we could change the world.
Yep.
I believe that. That's so vital. Now, of course, I couldn't give a top 10 list. You couldn't give a 10 list without Desiring God by John Piper. Piper is one of those guys whom I think his books tend to be a bit lengthy, especially his last book. but I've read most of his works, and very fruitful. Desiring God specifically, I've either read it 6 or 7 times because for me, this was this book, number one, shows that this is not in any type of order of quality.
Sure, yeah.
Because this is probably my favorite book of all time. But this book aids you in understanding why you follow Jesus. You know, what's the motivation? What's the heart behind it? This book rocked my world over 2 decades ago. It explains what Piper calls Christian hedonism, which can be either helpful or unhelpful. But basically what it means is God has designed the Christian life to be a pursuit of joy, specifically in finding joy in worshiping God.
Yeah, very simply, John Piper wants to convince you that following Jesus is about your own joy and that that's a good thing. And that is a very helpful message for a lot of people who have traditionally not understood that. If you think of following Jesus as just a drudging sacrifice, it is a sacrifice, but John Piper is going to show you how that's for your best and for your joy and a good thing. It changes your whole perspective about the Christian life. Mm-hmm. If you've had some bad thoughts in that area before.
I mean, he just lays out the greatest joy that can be known is the joy that God himself possesses. Yeah. And if God has it, you have to go to God to get it. It lays out chapters that really each chapter is about a different spiritual discipline. And then he explains how those spiritual disciplines should translate into really the pursuit of happiness, this pleasure in your life. Notable quote is, of course, the most famous quote from this book is that God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in him. And so extremely helpful book. Now, number 9 is a book that is so practical and theological at the same time. It's called Decision Making and the Will of God.
Yeah, I mean, everyone needs to read this book. It answers questions that everyone, I think, inevitably asks about following God and the will of God. It's like, what does God want for my life? How do I, even given, and this is a good placement in this list, given all this good theology, what do I do with my life practically? Like, what decisions, where do I go to college? Who do I marry? Mm-hmm. How do I find God's will? There have been several books actually had have come out after this that kind of copied what this book did. But this is the original, and it just in a very biblical but practical way, lays out this is what it means to find the will of God. And he does it in a way that if you've had some bad, this is again one that if you've had bad teaching on this topic where you've just been so concerned that if you don't make this exact right decision, you're going to be outside of God's will and the rest of your life's going to be ruined. Gary Friesen combats that in a biblical way and really allows you to find a lot of freedom in God's sovereignty. The other thing I'll say about this book is it's kind of a sneaky introduction to Calvinism.
Yeah.
It was for me.
Yeah.
But in a very helpful way that kind of lets you know, because God is sovereign, because he loves you, if you will obey him and if you will take scripture seriously, you can have freedom living in God's will.
Yeah. So many Christians are afraid of missing God's will. That they freak out and they treat God's will as if it's this dot on a timeline. Yeah. And if you miss that dot, you can never be in God's will. And I've seen so many people pervert God's will over the years to the extent where they're like, I missed God's will 15 years ago, so I need to divorce my wife. I need to quit my job. I need to abandon my family so I can go back and get God's will. And Friesen explains why that's stupid and why that's sinful and why God's will should never be understood in that vein. But he also does this amazing way of explaining God's will and our responsibility, that God has given us a responsibility to make choices through the lens of scripture, through the lens of his moral will. Yeah. And that's how worshiping God
works. The other
thing,
this book is great. If you're struggling at all with the idea of, okay, God is sovereign, so what responsibility do I have? This is an excellent book for helping you think through that, which I think is very practical. This is a book I try to get to every high schooler, every young person going to college. But frankly, if you haven't read it, you need to read it.
Everybody needs to read it. It'll help you be a better parent in guiding your children, especially if you're a parent of a teenager. I see, especially in our common era, I see parents of teenagers making very bad decisions about how they're guiding their kids to make decisions about their lives. And so for parenting, this is a really helpful book on how to guide your children. If you're 17 or 18 and trying to figure out your life, or even if you're a college senior, you know, you're about 21 or 22, man, go here. Yep. This will help you make good decisions. Now, notable quote: since no decision is made in a vacuum, the degree to which we pursue godly goals with righteous attitudes and wise actions will be largely determined by our perspective on life. In particular, the Christian whose worldview is shaped by Scripture will have a sense of self-identity different from the world's. Christians make different decisions. All right. Now, last but certainly not least is a book by a guy named Kevin DeYoung, Pastor Kevin DeYoung. What is the mission of the church? Man, if you want to understand how the pastors of Village Church make decisions, why we don't have all the ministries you want us to have, and why we'll never have the ministries that some of you peanut gallery people want us to have, What is the Mission of the Church is a book that I recommend you read to, number one, understand the mission of the church, because most people do not. But then secondly, it also helps you in understanding how to be a good church member. Yeah. If you want to understand how to be a good church member, you need to start with this book. It presents the church as having a specific purpose in the world that is not up for debate. DeYoung deals with it in such a good way, showing that God has revealed in the Bible the identity of the church and the mission of how the church is to live in this world.
It's also incredibly practical for your personal life, because we are the church. Mm-hmm. You are the church. And so you need to know what the mission of the church is. And so reading this book is going to, I think, also help direct your life in a very meaningful way. The other thing that I will say is, if people had just listened to this book, I think it came out in 2010, people had listened to what DeYoung was saying in this book, we would have avoided a lot of the mess evangelicalism is in right now, with social justice and with getting suckered by, you know, progressive politics in the church and a lot of things that are happening right now. This book is an antidote to a lot of those things, written far before most of the people had words for any of those things.
Well, one funny thing that I found in the acknowledgments and the recommendations is there are pastors that wrote glowing reviews of this book that 10 years later have gone so far into left field and denied every premise in this book.
Sad.
There are so many people with presuppositions based on experience, based on tradition, based on, well, I got hurt by this church, and so now I'm going to tell you how church ministry needs to go, how the church should function, or even what a healthy church is. But the question that this book answers and deals with is there a biblical defense for your view of the church?
Mm-hmm.
You know, can you point to in the scriptures why you think church exists for what you think it exists for?
Yeah.
So it gives very clear definitions. Here's a notable quote. The mission of the church is to go into the world and make disciples by declaring the gospel of Jesus and the power of the Spirit and gathering these disciples into churches that they might worship the Lord and obey his commands now and in eternity to the glory of God the Father. Very simple.
Yep.
That's the mission of the church. That's what we are to be about.
I think that's a wrap.
Yeah. You know, like, hey, there are 200 books
sure.
that we could have put on this list. We wanted to give 10 suggestions that are discipleship oriented with the everyday reader in mind. If you're upset that we didn't include John Owen, if you're upset that I didn't include Herman Bavinck on this list, here's the deal. You need to repent of being a nerd and being a snob. That's really, that's the only qualification that I can give you for the 10 books that we chose.
I got nothing to add. I hope these will be helpful for you. And yeah, our heart behind this really is we all need to grow in our discipleship. And this is just a basic starting point for that. So as a church, let's do it.
If you haven't read these books, get at it. We're going to include it in the show notes. So just click on the link. They will be provided below. But thank you so much for joining us. Leave us a 5-star review. Write a couple of sentences about why we are so great. Have an awesome day.